Welcome back to the Ruth Institute Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution here in Lake Charles, Louisiana. This afternoon, our program is a testimony panel for people who are survivors of the LGBT lifestyle, the LGBT subculture, you could say. Now, we originally had scheduled three participants on this panel. One of them was unable to come due to travel difficulties, so Luis Ruiz will not be participating today. But we do have with us today Laura Lauder, who was married to a man who left her to participate in the LGBT subculture. And then we also have Elizabeth Wanning, who would describe herself, I think, as once lesbian. And so we represent those aspects, those different aspects of the LGBT subculture. Now, I want to make clear, part of the reason we're doing this, part of the reason we're having these testimony panels, is to give voice to the people that we do not usually hear in the cultural conversation around these issues. So when we hear about people coming out and deciding they're gay and leaving their marriages and so on, we don't hear what it's like for the person who's left behind. When we hear about people deciding that they really have discovered their true identity as a gay person, we never hear about people who decide that that was not really truly their identity. And so we want to give voice to those people who are not commonly heard from. And that's the spirit in which we have this. And that's also the spirit in which we offered you last night Moira Graylin Pete's testimony about the experience of growing up with homosexually active parents, just so people could see that this is a part of the whole story, that this is a part of the story that doesn't normally get told. All right, Elizabeth Wanning, we're really looking forward to hearing what you have to say. Can you get your timer started there?
Yeah, quick, get that timer on because I will wax long. So my name's Elizabeth Wanning. I'm from Northern California, and I co-direct a ministry called Equipped to Love. And I'm a pastor at a church in Northern California that's non-denominational. I think I want to start just by saying that LGBTQ people, or LGBTQIA and the other letters that they tend to add to their identity, are really, they're being villainized by the church, and they're really lost. If you find yourself with the experience of same-sex attraction, and you do find yourself with that experience, then what do? Because you can either create, as Dr. Gagnon really described, you can create a way into the Gospels that seems to open up possibility by creating new doctrine, or you can believe that you were condemned from birth, because the cultural storyline is that you were born gay, and so therefore God is opposed to you. You were born to be destroyed. Or you can begin to look at culture's message, which is that any approach to resolve same-sex attraction is abusive and harmful, and so there's no avenue for hope of change. Or your final and last approach is to throw yourself at the mercy of Jesus and hope for something. And really, it's the last of those that is the one that I took. I came out in my early 20s. My bio describes that I had been diagnosed with bipolar disorder, and I quickly was embraced by the LGBT community. I was part of the Presbyterian Church. I surrounded myself by affirming Christians. I attended seminary openly gay. I was one of just a handful of students at the time who attended seminary openly gay. And so going into that experience, I had two beliefs. One, I had been born gay, and that I had a call to be a pastor. And now reconciling the two of those things for me was quite a challenge. If you love the things of God and yet find yourself with same-sex attraction, you really find yourself with despair. Anyone who's called to ministry knows the deep longing you have to walk that out. And so when I graduated from seminary, I had a strong philosophy of God coming from the PCUSA and a strong social justice message. I had been ministering to the gay community. I had been doing ministry in the LGBT community in Chicago, largely to teenagers, trying to extend a message of hope, a message of freedom from shame, so that people who experience same-sex attraction would be drawn to Christ. Now, what I discovered after I left seminary was that you could access the love of Jesus and it could make an impact in your life. Until I left seminary, until I left the world of reason and philosophy and doctrine and brought my faith experience down to, can you know Jesus? Can you experience the love of Christ? And if so, what are the implications of that? If I had not had that revelation, I would never have tried to leave the gay community. And that revolution is largely missing in most of our communication to the gay community, that Jesus does have answers, that he does contend for the restoration of our sexuality, that the gospel has hope for wholeness for LGBT people, is not being largely heard by the broader community. As a result of that vacuum, these new movements are emerging. The gay Christian movement is emerging. Or in our culture, this very adamant push against the church is happening because the hope of the gospel is being extended. I often tell people that the power of the pride movement is fueled by the depth of the shame of people who experience LGBTQ. Anyone who has experienced shame knows that if someone approaches you and puts your finger on the thing that is the most painful, you'll have a violent pushback. Mm-hmm. And so we wonder at the violent and aggressive approach of members of the LGBTQ community towards Christians in particular. And it's because Christianity has so far not offered resolution to people with this experience, and instead offered painful approaches even, or exclusion. And so out of shame, there's this huge pushback. And we see it in our families where a young child will come out, you know, a 12, 13-year-old boy or girl will come out to their parents, and their immediate reaction to their Christian parents is, I must leave my family. Because they've never heard any kind of storyline that says, Jesus has answers for you. The life of surrendered Christianity is hopeful. It's virtuous. It offers life. Same-sex sexual fulfillment is not paramount to enjoying and having a successful life. We don't hear that. We don't learn how to have meaningful same-sex, same-gendered relationships very commonly either. Another problem that I see happening in our culture with LGBTQ is that the born gay narrative is largely a male gay narrative. Women are victims of the LGBTQ culture and narrative. And when I say that, you only have to track recent history to know that the lesbian movement started as a political pushback against a male-dominated culture or a perceived male-dominated culture. Gloria Steinem or those of her generation in the 60s and 70s, lesbianism was a political statement made against men. I was a third-wave feminist. In that position, I believed that men were largely irrelevant, that feminism or femininity was superior to masculinity. This is before I experienced the love of Jesus and re-evaluated everything that I had come to believe about myself. My life in Christ, my experience of his love, and the healing that he gave me both from mental illness as well as sexual restoration, resolved for me long-standing rejection of my femininity and the approaches that I had taken to have female power. But lesbianism in recent history now has come into this place of victimhood through the born gay ideology, so that many women today who maybe were sexually assaulted or molested as children, who maybe act out on sexual desires with women because they have been abused by men, that is, they find themselves much more familiar with female love and much safer in the company of women, instead of trying to resolve that problem of self-rejection or self-safety, instead of seeking answers for that, they're going to this dialogue that says, well, even though I was molested, I surely was born gay. And so therapeutic approaches for those women are being withheld, because today in the U.S. there's a strong push to ban any kind of conversion therapy. And that would be any kind of therapy that would approach orientation as if it could change or be resolved. And so women are the victims of conversion therapy bans, largely, in my opinion. With 45 seconds left, so well timed, I want to just bring your attention to this book that I have on my table back in the back, Changed. Over the last year, my ministry partner and I, Ken Williams, became involved in some of the legislation that's happening across the U.S. that's approaching conversion therapy. And last year in the state of California, they introduced legislation that would cause any kind of approach to orientation, suggesting that orientation could change, that would declare it to be fraud. That would mean any book, for example, that would be sold in the state of California that would suggest orientation could change or that sexual desires could be resolved, couldn't be sold in the state of California, much less any kind of therapy offered. So Ken and I were in a committee hearing, and in the committee hearing in the state capitol, we both shared our testimonies of how we had not only come out of LGBTQ, but both of us no longer experienced same-sex attraction by virtue of our faith. And when we said that, one of the assemblymen turned to us and said, "I don't believe your testimony, and I don't believe there are other people like you." And so Ken and I, we were driving home, musing over what we could do. And we quickly called 50 of our friends. And we thought, let's publish a book. And so we published the first edition of Changed. And then we invited everybody to show up about a month later at the state capitol. And we handed out a copy of Changed to every state senator. We took hand-delivered to every office, a group of us, and talked to staffers about being changed. And then all of us stood on the state capitol steps, and we shared our testimonies. It was about 2.5 hours of testimonies publicly made about how we had left the LGBT lifestyle. Today, or really just last month, Nancy Pelosi reintroduced the National Equality Act. And this past week, Ken was in the National Capitol, once again carrying around our Changed book. And we're doing our very best to get the message out that actually people do change. People have been changing for centuries, really, leaving disordered sexual desires through the restoration of Christ. And so I just want to say, I guess in closing, that the church has answers. Jesus has answers for people who experience sexual brokenness. Not only that, he has resolution and wholeness available for people. And I hope that the church will begin to open its doors to welcome people to get over and get past the conundrum of how do I even talk about this issue, get past all our own shame, so that we can actually extend the gospel to LGBT people. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Was that not cool? Was that not cool? So, thank you, both of you, very much. This is very helpful. And I encourage people to write your questions on the cards and bring them up here. But before somebody does that, I'm sure people have thoughts and questions that they want to share. But I have a couple of questions. I'll just kind of lead off. You made a point that it's very interesting to me, which is when you said that you felt that the born gay narrative is a gay male narrative that marginalizes women. The reason that interests me is because I've been kind of tracking for a while this claim, the born gay claim, you know, just the science of it, and it seems strange to me. How would anyone believe? I honestly think the people who are working in that area of studying the origins of same-sex attraction, I don't think any serious person thinks that the same argument would apply to men as to women. You know, if you really look at it, there is not a serious person doing research. Even the people who say born gay, because born gay means something different in each case. Mm-hmm. So I would like for you to elaborate on that a little bit, just because that I think that point is a new point, probably a new thought for a lot of people, the difference between male and female origins and just what the born gay narrative means something different to the men than to the women. Tell us more.
Well, Dr. Lisa Diamond, her studies on sexual fluidity, I think it's pretty well documented that women's sexual experience is fluid, more fluid than for men, largely because of brain structure, if for no other reason. And, you know, I would say the strength, the political strength of the LGBT community has overrun women, and that, as is normal, I think, in our culture, we do tend to marginalize the voices of women. And the LGBT community is no exception to that. I mean, when you look at the gay pride parade, or you look at any gay culture, you see largely male gay culture. You do not see lesbian culture in the same light. And even if for me to say that lesbian sexuality is largely fluid, that's really easily dismissed by most of our culture. And so I don't know what to add to that, except that when you look at all of the statistical evidence that's being brought right now in the cultural forums, very little of it actually addresses the woman's experience. That's a huge vacuum, in my opinion.
Yes, and what it also suggests to us as members of the church in various ways is that our response to a girl with same-sex attraction may be different than our response to a boy with same-sex attraction. There may be something different behind it. It may mean something different to them. Maybe you can add to that a little bit.
Well, yeah, absolutely, I can add to that. One of the big areas that I think is largely missing in our conversations is how we form meaningful relationships one to another. And in our culture, we are not doing a good job at articulating the difference between women's relationships one to another and men's relationships one to another, so that any kind of intimate relationship now in our culture is being sexualized. And women in particular who form emotional relationships, they will tend to form codependent relationships, and those will be sexualized. And unraveling that for women, walking women through inordinate emotional relationships, could actually help thousands of women who feel like that emotional relationship is the indicator that they're actually lesbian, when in fact that's not the case. And I would say, I can't tell you the number of very young women, 14, 15, 16, who presume that because they've developed an emotional attachment to another woman, they presume that they're lesbian. And so because of our cultural narrative, they will go ahead and sexualize that relationship instead of having a body of women available to mentor younger women in our churches, especially, into what healthy relationships look like.
Here's another question, and this perhaps both of you could answer this, but particularly for Elizabeth. How would you recommend beginning a conversation with a family member who's identifying as gay? I know what I say, but I want to hear what you have to say.
Well, gosh, there are so many different variables in that conversation. First of all, how much relational capital do you have with that family member? I mean, if this family member is not close to you, then you really don't have very much to say that would touch on that point of shame that I was talking about. You have no right to offer input that's guiding that person in their self-understanding if you have no real existing relationship with them, in my opinion. So first of all, what's the nature of your relationship? If you're close, then I would want to be able to create a situation where you can cultivate conversations around how it is that they believe that they're gay, mm-hmm. how it is that they first began experiencing same-sex desires, and what they have done, how it has impacted them emotionally, how they intend to steward their sexuality, if they're Christian in particular, how they desire to protect their sexuality for their sense of well-being.
Do you know, what I would say is similar to that, but I just, because I'm not a therapist and don't pretend to be a therapist, what I would just tell people, if you have a family member who says, Mom, I think I'm gay, the first thing I would suggest is that you say, what do you mean by that? Because you don't even know really what they might mean. They might mean all sorts of mm-hmm. things, but that opens the conversation, yeah. at least.
I mean, I do try to encourage parents when their children come out to stay in relationship to the very best of their ability with their children. Because all too often, so if you can picture this, when you experience same-sex attraction, you ponder that sometimes for years. I pondered my same-sex attraction for probably 7 years before I came out. So that by the time I came out, I had fully convinced myself that it was the case. And so when you've taken that much time to question and evaluate what you're experiencing, and then you step out into it, that openness of coming out, that moment of coming out, for me was very cathartic. It was life-changing for me to suddenly say, this is who I am. And so at that point, I was willing to risk everything that I believed about it, because now I was putting a stake in the ground. I've compared it often to giving your life to Jesus. So
let me interrupt you right there on that point, though. So in those 7 years while you were churning this in your mind and working on it in your mm-hmm. mind, is there something that someone might have done during that period of time that would have been helpful to you?
Yeah, definitely.
Tell us about that.
If I had been able to approach my parents or to approach peers who would have been able to, rather than shame me, rather than say, oh no, this is not the truth about who you are, or this is not what you're actually feeling, but actually help me understand how the feelings even began. How did the thought even get placed in my mind? You know, would you know that so many people come to question their sexuality simply because of an obtrusive thought,
mm-hmm.
simply because someone else proposed that it's the truth about who you are? You know, I was super androgynous as a young girl, a tomboy, and I began to evaluate that as, oh, I must be lesbian.
Mm-hmm.
But what if someone had asked me, especially my parents, is there something about being a girl that makes you feel uncomfortable? Is there something about showing up as a woman that you're uncomfortable with? I would have said, absolutely, I don't want to be a woman. And following that train of thought would have been a really great conversation that might have caused me to question what I had believed.
But today, if you have that kind of conversation, a lot of times that ends up at the transgender clinic. Mm. That really you are a boy.
Yeah, if you affirm that.
Right. So we now have many other kind of cultural landmines
mm-hmm,
around that type of question. So given that we're trying to create a safe and supportive and a biblically sound environment for people, what are some of the ways and some of the messages we could create within our communities that would allow people to, have the space to have that conversation? I realize it's getting more and more complicated in a place like California where you're not even allowed to say certain things and stuff. But tell us, give us a little something to chew on and think about how we might open up that conversation for people.
The conversation for people, can you be more specific?
So I'm thinking about this young person, right? Mm-hmm. I'm thinking about this questioning young person and how we can be helpful to them. And, you know, if a kid says, "Mom, I think I'm gay," that's probably not the time to bring out the Jesus sex text. You know, no offense, Rob, but I mean that's probably not what they're really talking about, right?
Well,
and so that shame
the
thing.
The very first place is addressing the shame.
Yeah, the shame thing is really important. Yeah. So say some more about that.
The very first place is to be able to express that no matter what that person is experiencing, you are not going to leave them, because so much of the experience is filled with self-rejection. So there's so much rejection going on inside. So if you've either rejected your gender or your own sexual expression, you're going to project that on everybody. And right. So you're going to run from anybody who might touch that. And so creating a safe place, first of all, saying, "I want to hear what you're feeling. How is this painful for you? How does it make you feel when I say X, Y, or Z? How can we create a place of safety for you?" And actually having conversations that ask open-ended questions so that there's self-exploration that can happen in verbal processing that doesn't have the implication of, "I have to say the right answer in order for you to stay in relationship with me." I think that's one of the first places we have to start, because usually what happens is, because of the shame, you just want to run away. And you're going to run away to the LGBT community.
Right.
And the reality is, the LGBT community is there ready to embrace you no matter what. You know, until recently, I could say easily that I found more community, more acceptance, more love in the gay community than I ever found in the church. And part of that is because in the church, we actually don't form the same kind of lifelong, lasting bonds, unconditional love in our churches that we wish we had. We don't create family environments often in our churches. And in the gay community, there's no standard for behavior that you have to meet. Whereas in church, nobody is the real person in church. We don't ever, not even me today, I don't ever get to be just me because I'm being conformed daily to the image of Christ. None of us Christians want to be who we are today. And so it's a slippery slope of community and just belonging and being okay with yourself, even in your brokenness.
Along that line, though, but when you came out as a Christian, I suppose you might say, or when you left the lesbian community, what kind of pressure or pushback did you receive about that?
Well, you know, every bridge was burned, pretty much.
Yeah.
I mean, my friends all are waiting for me to come back to the truth of who I am, a lesbian.
Right.
They're waiting for my marriage to fail.
And how long have you been married?
Soon to be 14 years.
See? Wow. And they're still waiting? Well, I do have more questions, but I think that's all the time that we have that we need to wrap this up. But I would like to say before you guys leave the table here, that your book, Changed, I feel like is comparable to Layla Miller's book about the children of divorce, because it's an honest recounting of people who don't normally get a turn at the microphone. Mm-hmm. And so before you leave, if you would, visit with my friend Rachel back there, because she runs a bookstore, the Ruth bookstore, and we would love to carry that in our store alongside
awesome.
Primal Loss. I think that would be a great addition to our book collection, so you guys do that. So thank you. Let's thank Elizabeth and Laura.
Thank you so much. I enjoyed it.
All right. Well, do we get a team photo here before they leave the stage? Sure. Yeah, you're right. And nobody did anything mean.
There are no picketers outside.
No. We did a exorcism on the building yesterday.
I had a friend who used to bury miraculous medals around the park where the Atlanta Pride was held.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
Okay, we're gonna. I get the last word because it's my party. So I guess what I'll do. I guess I'll sit down and talk. That'll work. So I want to thank all of you guys for coming to the Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution. And I want to say just a few words. After the proceedings close, there will be a few opportunities for interviews if there's a last person or two that wants to be interviewed. And this material will be archived online so people can see it permanently if any of your friends have missed it. And the interviews that we're doing here with the participants, those will be available eventually as well. I'd like to just wrap up this conference with just a few thoughts about the sexual revolution and the Ruth Institute's response to the sexual revolution, because we've seen many elements of it here, and I just want to draw out some of the common threads that we've heard in the last day and a half. And the sexual revolution, if you've read The Sexual State, I define the sexual revolution as having three main ideologies that are interlocking ideologies. And before I tell you what they are, I want to tell you that they all come back to that text that Rob Gagnon pointed out to us earlier, which is the primacy, the foundation of the male-female, the male-female separation. I don't know how exactly to say it, but the difference between male and female, the fact of male and female, is the primal fact of creation, and it's the primal fact of human identity, and it's the primal fact of, it's the foundation of sexual ethics and Christian sexual ethics. So now I'm going to tell you what I think are the three parts of the sexual revolution, and you'll see how every one of them, it comes back to that point, all right? So the first point is that the sexual revolution, the ideology of the sexual revolution, says that a good and decent society should do everything possible to separate sex from babies, that we should be allowed to have guilt-free, child-free sex, and that we're all entitled to that. I call that the contraceptive ideology. And that thought is the foundation of the demand for abortion on demand and contraception on demand, and many other things flow from that. The second point is that a good and decent society should do everything possible to separate both sex and babies from marriage, which is to say you can have sex without being married, you can have a baby without being married, and the underlying thought there is the kids don't really need their parents, that it's not really all that important whether you have both of your parents. And that, obviously, is the divorce ideology. And not only does divorce itself flow from that, but the idea that single parenthood is really okay, same-sex parenting is really okay, third-party reproduction is completely unproblematic, all of that flows from that one thought, the kids don't really need their parents. The third point of the sexual revolution is what I call the gender ideology, and this is what Pope Francis also calls it, and that is the idea that the fact of male and female is not particularly significant, and we can, if we choose, completely overwrite the differences between men and women. And I used to kind of joke around, I was very interested in what Elizabeth had to say as a third, describing herself as a third wave feminist. When I was in college, the idea was that men and women were completely identical, interchangeable. We were supposed to be and do whatever the men could be and do. That was all, that's what was supposed to happen. That kind of feminism said men and women are identical, except women are better. And that's where we are, you know, that's kind of what she suggested, that third wave feminism means that women are better. Well, that has morphed into transgenderism, interestingly enough, which both of those things have the implication that the body is not particularly significant. So now, can you pause and see that all three of these things go back to that foundational creation text? The sexual revolutionaries resent the human body. They resent the fact that we're male and female. They are angry that we cannot be really the same. They are angry that this thing that gives us pleasure, sexual activity, results in so many inconveniences, such as children and attachments. They resent all of that. And so, therefore, the divorce ideology follows naturally from that, which says that somehow we will set aside out of our minds the thought that kids actually need their parents, and that that imposes obligations on us as adults. That's what the sexual revolution is doing to us. So the problem with that, all three of those ideas are false. They're all untrue. Sex does make babies. Everybody on board with that? Okay, good. Sex makes babies. Kids need their parents, and men and women really are different. That's true. That's all true. Now, so if you're going to build a society around the opposite of that, you have to suppress all the evidence that comes up that contradicts it. If you believe the kids need their parents, that view will be confirmed by the facts. If you believe men and women are different, that will be confirmed by the facts. If you believe men and women are not particularly different, there's no significance to the body, you've got to do a lot of tap dancing and a lot of suppressing and a lot of tamping down to put a stop to that. And particularly, if you think sex makes babies, that view will be confirmed on a regular basis. And if you think it doesn't, you're going to have a problem explaining that. So that explains the kind of rapid fire propaganda that we're all subjected to, and it explains also why so many voices have to be suppressed. That's why the children of divorce feel like they can't speak out. That's why you've got actual laws on the books trying to stop people from changing from gay to straight, right? And defining a whole category of identity from which people cannot deviate. The whole attack on crisis pregnancy centers is of the same sort of thing. It's saying that we do not allow dissent from the contraceptive ideology. So all of that is a necessary part of keeping the sexual revolutionary ideology going. And that is why the Ruth Institute has committed itself to creating an environment where we can actually talk about the reality of these things. That if we could just get the children of divorce, just to take this one example, the children of divorce all marching together in the same direction, that's a lot of people. And when you think about how much it takes to suppress all of the sad feelings that all these kids have had for their whole lives, weren't Lila Miller's stories unbelievable? I mean, it's unbelievable how much people have to suppress in order to maintain the view that divorce is harmless. Well, that means there are a lot of people walking around brokenhearted. A lot of people walking around with pathology, serious pathology, that they can't get help for, right? And you can see it in the pro-life movement. When you look at the fact that abortion is supposed to be nothing more than pulling a tooth, you know, clipping your fingernails, it's not significant whatsoever. It's been in the professional literature since at least 1990 that at least 10% of women experience serious trauma from their abortions. But we're not allowed to talk about it. You know, that's crazy. But that's what we're dealing with. And that's that. So it's great that we're all here dealing with these issues, talking about them, and hanging in there with each other, even when the conversation gets uncomfortable. And I want to really endorse what Elizabeth had to say about that, that staying in relationship with one another is extremely important. We're in this for keeps. We're in this for the long haul. And if I say something stupid and hurt somebody's feelings, I want to come back and try to deal with the fact that I said something stupid and hurt somebody's feelings, because that's how you keep a family together anyway, right? That's what you have to do. That's what it's all about. So the other thing that Elizabeth said that I think is particularly important is she touched on the question of shame. And earlier, I think it was last night, somebody brought up the question of natural law. How did you know, Moira Grayland, how did you know that there was something wrong with how you were being raised if that was all you had ever known? And the answer to that was, well, you know, the truth in some way is written on the heart. And you can know, you can naturally revolt against certain things happening and certain things being done to you. So that whole truth of things is in some way embodied within us, and we know something about it. And that means that if we're going to get people to talk about these issues and talk about the harms of the sexual revolution, one of the big problems we have is the problem of shame, the problem of the guilty conscience. There are millions of people who have participated in the sexual revolution. In fact, a priest friend of mine said to me once, most people are probably both victims and perpetrators at this point. And I think that's right. Many people are perpetrators as well as victims. So the problem is being able to speak about that without debilitating shame. You know, a small amount of shame is actually a good thing. The shame that tells you I did something wrong and I need to stop doing it, there's nothing wrong with that. But boy, it only takes like a little pinch of shame for you to really be motivated, right? If you start piling it on, then it's crushing. And so we we can't go there. So that's what I just want to mention to you, that as we have worked on this issue over the last 5 years at the Ruth Institute, we have noticed that while in the abstract, getting victims and survivors of the sexual revolution to act, that that's a great concept and it works and everything, problem is that shame. That problem is people's woundedness. That's in the way a lot of times of getting people activated. So I just want to point that out because I don't think most people see. I think this is something that the church can uniquely talk about, because what's the antidote to shame? Behaving yourself, number one, and forgiveness and repentance, number two. The secular world can't compete with that, the forgiveness and repentance part. We should be able to do this, you guys, right? We have the tools on hand. We should be able to do this. So I want to thank all of you for coming. And what I want to close with is two thoughts. Number one, we have certificates of completion back there at the back table, and I want all of you to go pick them up for your participation here, just so you have them for your record, so that you can say, I was there. I was there. Because this is the beginning of something big. Do you think? This beginning of something big, something good? Yeah? The second thing I want to say is I want to show you this little pin that I'm wearing. It's a little Ruth Institute pin. And we have talked numerous times this weekend about the importance of listening to one another. The Ruth Institute logo and the Ruth Institute pin, it's my dream that this become a cultural symbol. That if you see somebody wearing this pin, that people will know, oh, that's a person who will listen to me. That's a person I could talk to. You know, when priests are out in their clerical collars, Father Sullins will tell you this, a lot of times people come up to him and start confessing at the in the grocery store. You know, I mean, it happens, right? Because that's collars, a symbol. Well, you know what? We can be symbols. We can have our own symbol that will listen without judgment and that will accompany you. And so I want each of you to receive one of these pins as a memento of your participation and as a sign of your enlistment in the crusade to put a stop to the sexual revolution and to create a civilization of love. Thank you very much.